still talking.
Hello, people.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see you. Please stand as we begin our time of worship.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope.
Take part in our blended service. You can see that Monty and I are expressing two different ways of worshiping this morning. So, all right. We want to welcome you to Fern Creek United Methodist Church, both here, those who are with us, and those who are with us online via Facebook Live. Thank you so much for being a part of our worship. Am I on? I think I am. All right. We do have a couple of announcements. Just don't know what they are. Oh, they're not on the screen. All kinds of things going on here at church. We have Sunday school classes getting ready to be up and running. We have a couple we'll be having today. We're back to our old hours of 9 and 11:15, so the Sunday school classes can meet. Jim's chomping at the bit.
Yeah. Also, hey, this is a glory sighting, too, that I get to share right now. But anyway, but also we're going to start children's church back. Any children want to say amen to that or praise God or clap or whatever? So you'll be going to children's church today after the children's message as well. Yeah, and I sent an email out concerning schedules for like adult Sunday school classes. Some are a couple of meeting today. I think one starts next week and others will be starting, you know, in the weeks ahead. So just kind of check with your teacher on that. And then on the May 2nd, the first Sunday of May, the children and youth classes will start back. So we're excited. Those are good glory sightings coming up. So thanks.
Amen. That's well, there you go. Thank you so much, Jim. Our psalm for this morning. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar, Lord Almighty, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in the house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs, the autumn rains also cover with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Hear my prayer. Lord God Almighty, listen to me, God of Jacob. Look on your shield, O God. Look with favor on your anointed one. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk in blamelessness. Lord Almighty, blesses the one who trusts in you. Mm-hmm. Our Lord God, we are here, gathered this morning as a people of God, as the body of Christ. We trust in your love. We trust in your watch care over us. We ask you this morning that you bless our worship experience. We pray these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to do something else different. This will be the first Sunday. We're going to invite our children actually to come back, at least kind of close to where you used to come to. And we've got some little blue X's here where you guys can sit. If you're brothers and sisters, you can sit together if you would like. So just kind of find maybe an X there, and I'll kind of move back. And you know, this is great because there's six of you, six X's. We might have put out more for next time, too. So that's good. Come on in, guys. It's great to see all of you. And yeah, you can sit or stand if you want to. It doesn't matter if you want to sit down. You know, we've been kind of used to sitting up here about a year ago, right? And so we're just trying to slowly get back to that. So if you want to sit or stand, you can. But it's great to see you all. I want to ask you, first of all, how many of you like to go out to eat with maybe your family or your friends or family and friends? How many like to do that, to go out to eat? And fortunately, we're starting kind of getting to do that again, right? In fact, I think you guys got to do that this week, didn't you? I saw some pictures of you guys on vacation. So if you're thinking about being someplace with your family or just with a few friends that might be with you at the table, what are some things that you do at the table when you go out to eat? It's a real tough question. One of y'all just share what you might do. Anybody? When we go out to eat, what might we do at the table? Eat, yeah, there we go, there we go. That's good. What else might you do besides eating? In fact, that's one reason I like to go to the table to eat. What else do we do at the table a lot of times if you're with your family and friends? You talk, yeah. In fact, some of our best conversations is when we're at the table, isn't it? And that's one of the best times I get close to people is having a meal with them and talking to them. Well, today we're looking at a story in which Jesus is going to be at a table with two of his disciples. And he's going to be sharing with them. and he's going to do something special with them. Now, before that happened, this was the day that Jesus rose from the grave. And these two disciples, they were kind of disheartened because they hadn't seen Jesus yet. He had gone to the cross. Go ahead. Easter. There you go. Good. Good job. It's Easter. It rose. The tomb was empty. But these two disciples hadn't seen him, and so they were still a little disheartened, and they're talking about Jesus. That's what they're doing. They're walking on a road, and then Jesus comes up to them, and they still don't recognize him. They hadn't seen him yet, the resurrection. And while they're there, walking on this 7-mile walk with Jesus, he starts telling them who he is through the scriptures. Now, they still don't recognize him until, guess what? They get to their place, and it's almost night, and they invite Jesus to eat with them. Just like we invite people to go eat, that's right. And while they're at the table, it says this, that Jesus would take bread, okay, he would bless it, he would break it, and then he would give it. And then it's like their eyes were open, and they saw Jesus, and I can't explain all this to you, but in the next second, he was gone. But you know what? Their hearts felt really good. And because they realized Jesus was alive and that he had been with them the whole time they were on that walk together. Now, when we talked about the taking the bread and breaking it, blessing it, breaking it, giving it, oftentimes we think of communion. Y'all remember on communion we used to have the loaves of bread and break them and then the cup. Now, we've gone to the little cups now because of the COVID, but a lot of times it points to that table. That's a communion table. But guess what? A lot of stuff happens at the table with Jesus. Not just that kind of communion, but fellowship and good things and teaching. And guess what? You're going to get to go to a time of being at the table. You might not have a physical table there, but you're going for a time of fellowship and teaching. And you're going to get to go to children's church. And I'm sure you're really going to enjoy it because you won't have to hear me, like, tell you a Greek word and what it means. I'm pretty sure Beth or Mia, or who's ever teaching, won't be doing that, will you? But y'all are going to have fun, and so I'm thankful for you. You're going to be really at the table with Jesus now in children's church. So let's pray for you guys and right now. Heavenly Father, thank you for the children. It is such a blessing to see them, to be this close to them again. And, Lord, I just pray that you pour out your blessing upon them. May they see you as they go to children's church now, and just have a good time learning about you and sharing together. In Jesus' name, amen. And I see Beth in the back, so y'all can go back to the back, and Katie, and y'all can head out to children's church.
Please stand with me as we sing, O Thou Who Out This Mysterious Bread. Soon. that God and love are one.
Thank you so much, Pam. Please be seated. As we head into our time of prayer, you may have a glory sighting you'd like to express or a prayer concern you'd like to share that we may pray with and for you. Just if you would, raise your hands from where you are, and we'll be glad to acknowledge that. Yes.
My mom, Sheila, is currently at home battling a kidney stone.
Okay, Sheila at home with a kidney stone. Someone else this morning.
First is a praise. Jesslyn's father, Justin, got home Monday and is doing really well from recovering from the COVID he had. And he goes Tuesday for a checkup and might get released for work, which is really good.
Amen.
And then also to pray for a brother-in-law, Daryl Crutzer, who's at Audubon with severe stomach issues, possibly from past COVID things as well. So that's for Daryl. And then let's continue to pray for Jean Pointek, who had her knee surgery and is recovering and doing well. So continue to pray for her also.
Amen. Thank you, Jim.
And the family of Betty Moore, I meant to mention them. That funeral will be tomorrow. The visitation for Betty will be down at Rest Haven, where the cemetery is, the Hetty Funeral Home at Rest Haven. That's from 11 to 2 for the family. And they're due to the limited numbers and having a pretty good-sized family that it's going to be a private funeral. But thanks for all the prayers for Betty's family. And we're going to celebrate her life. She's lived it well, and we're going to give thanks for her tomorrow.
Thank you, Jim.
Daryl.
Yes.
Glenn Hamill is having some issues. We need to remember him in prayer. Lori Disler's sister, Diane Jurgens, is her cancer markers are up, and they're doing some more testing. And my neighbors, Ron and Judy, they are snowbirds, and they were down south for 3 months, came back, visited family, caught COVID. And he is 80 and still in the hospital. She just got out of the hospital, but she said they can't get his oxygen level to even go up. So if you could remember Ron and Judy.
Thanks, Rose. Yes, Mike. Mike's sister-in-law and family has COVID. Please be in prayer for them. Lucy?
Yes.
Dick Widener?
Yeah. I want to thank everyone for the prayers and the cards that I've received. I've never made it without you. Mm-hmm. I promise you. Mm-hmm. I've never made it without Greg, and I definitely would not have made it without Betty. Mm-hmm. So I do appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thanks. You bet. Thanks, Arlene. Almost said Tyler. Go, Monty. Yeah,
Mary.
So my Chris leaving?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Gotcha. His friend Chris, who's with him all week long, spending time with him, is his last day is Friday. He's having a new friend coming on board. Anyone else? All right, let's pray. Lord God, we gather this morning as the body of Christ to worship you, to experience worship together, to have the opportunity to pray to you and supplicate, to ask for your watch care, to ask for our prayers to be answered. We have folks here who are dealing with loss, folks who are dealing with illness, folks who have family who are enduring the virus. We have folks who are dealing, I'm sure, with financial issues due to all that's been going on. Father, we ask, Lord, that your will be done with every church member, every family member, every person watching on via Facebook. We ask that you would bring peace to our community as we think about the people in certain areas of our country. We ask, Lord, that cool heads would prevail as all kinds of things are sprouting up here and there. Father, we ask, Lord, more than anything right now, that you as a church are help us as a church to be a witness in times of upheaval, witness in times of tumult and trouble, witness in a time of pain and heartache. May we love where others won't. May we show kindness where others refuse. May we reach out to those whom others will not. May we be patient where others may not be as patient. May we turn the other cheek when those are seeking vengeance or revenge. May we show others that we are different in the sense that we are Sermon on the Mount different, that we are ready to go the extra mile, that we are ready to turn the other cheek, that we are ready to give someone something when they're asking to borrow it. Help us, Lord, to remember that upside down world that you brought. Help us to remember that we are to be servant-minded and humble and loving and caring. And we gather together as a church, and we're able to come together and lift one another up and to encourage one another up and to leave this place and to do so for others. We're so grateful for that. And we're grateful for this opportunity as a church family to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Once he walked beside me, like he'd been there all along. Not a stranger, but a father who can sense when something's wrong. And he answered all my questions and understood fears that somehow vanished now that he was here. Can't you see who walks with you? Can't you hear who speaks your name? Can't you feel something stirring? His words ring strong and true, like a once familiar string. Can the past we follow from now on be the same? Him to leave me, so I begged him please to stay, spend the evening a few moments before he went his way. Then like a host he stood and blessed me, broke the bread and poured the wine. Then I there was something there I recognized. Yes, I can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain. And I know I'll never be the same. I can see
Amen. What a beautiful song on this Emmaus Road experience. One of the first of the resurrection appearances of Jesus. We know his first was to Mary Magdalene or to the ladies according to Matthew's gospel. But this would be very close to it. And I want to read some scripture partway through that story of the Emmaus Road experience. And I'm going to pick up with verse 28. And about the two disciples now and Jesus. As they approached, it's chapter 24, verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" And they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. And there they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord is risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Let us bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you again for who you are. I thank you for just this beautiful song describing this experience of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Being able to look back and recognize your presence with them as their eyes were opened in the breaking of the bread. And Lord, I thank you for that presence. I thank you for your love that draws us, that we might be connected to you in this relationship. And a love that will connect us in such a way that, as Daryl has prayed earlier, that we can go and share a love that can help connect others to you. And I pray, come Holy Spirit, and continue to draw us into the depths of who you are. We love you. And Lord, we want others to know and experience this love that you have as well. Come Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Now, I started that story, this wonderful resurrection story of the Emmaus Walk, kind of in an unusual place, and that would be toward the end of the story, at least for these two disciples. And I did that for a reason. I want to focus, in fact, today on a couple of the images, actually about three. One of those being this table that the disciples will be at with Jesus. And there'll be some other images as well. Now, we know in Luke's gospel, the table or the meal setting was a very important place. And you can go back and look at all the meals in Luke's gospel, and you'll see all these different things take place. The table is a place of hospitality. It is a place of welcome. It is a place of fellowship. It is a place of family. It is a place for teaching at times. It is a place for dialogue. It was at the table that people would experience reconciliation, and people would experience forgiveness as well. And don't forget, the table was a place of worship. It was all of these things. In fact, for them and for us today, it is a place of welcome. This table, this place, is a place of belonging, a place for each of us to experience a connection with Jesus Christ. Now, for these two disciples, Cleopas and an unnamed disciple, and by the way, neither of these are two of the 11 disciples. These are other disciples that knew and walked with Jesus. At this table, they will get, if I can use this word today, reconnected to Jesus. But now, they're going to get connected to the resurrected Christ. Now, before I go back to those images and another image in a moment, I want to back up earlier in the day. Now, sometime Easter afternoon, Christ is risen. They've not seen him yet, but Cleopas, and I want to show there's a Emmaus. There are many pictures of the Emmaus Road. This is a particular picture of Jesus with these two disciples. And by the way, they're leaving Jerusalem. They're going, or they're going and heading to Emmaus. They'll be leaving Jerusalem and heading to Emmaus that you'll see in this picture. Now, that was a long road. It was predicted to be about 7 miles to get to Emmaus. Now, doing all the walking and the steps I'm doing, Daryl can confirm this as well, to walk 7 miles when you're talking and having dialogue, it's probably going to take over 2 hours, right, Daryl? 2 to 3 hours. It's a long walk. And at first, these two disciples are walking by themselves, and they're not only talking about the things that have happened, the word is they're discussing. They're analyzing, as you talked about last week. They're trying to figure out what they have experienced in such a powerful way of the last week of Jesus' life. And at that point, that's when Jesus kind of steals up to them and begins to walk with them. Now, it's interesting in the scriptures, it says this word. They are kept from recognizing him. It's probably a divine thing that God, in some way, had kept these two disciples from recognizing him. And he simply asked him, and probably overhearing what they're discussing, what are you talking about? What are you discussing? And it's an interesting reply from one of these disciples. It's almost like, what rock have you been under? You know, don't you know what's happened in Jerusalem over these last 3 days? And it's there that these disciples, it says in the scriptures, are very downcast and they're disheartened. It's been tough days. It's been tough days. But then they begin to share about Jesus of Nazareth, this prophet who was powerful both in word and deed. The leaders had him arrested, turned him over, handed him over. He's crucified, a death sentence, crucified on the cross. And then they say these words, and we had hoped he would be the one who would redeem Israel for us. And by the way, we've heard some interesting news. The women went to the tomb and found it empty, and the angels have said Jesus is alive. But they're still uncertain at the time. And that's when Jesus begins to connect the dots for these two disciples. And it says he goes all the way back to Moses, and don't miss it, he goes to all the prophets. Anybody want to name all the prophets that speak of him? It's a long walk to Emmaus. And he begins to connect those dots for them of all the scripture they'd probably grown up with that would point to Jesus. But they still don't recognize him. But I want to tell you, I don't know about you, but if we'd been hearing Jesus teach for 2 hours or so on a road, the scriptures, I think we would beg him to stay with us too. Anybody want to say that? Will you please stay the night with us, Jesus? It's getting late. In fact, the word there, when they ask him to stay, is almost a word that they kind of forced him to stay. You can't leave. You've got to come in. And it's while they're at that table, a powerful thing happens. We'll show another picture here, just one from, and I love this moment. When they're at the table, at their home or their lodging place, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks. And he broke it, and he gave it. And it's in that moment that this picture shows that they can see again. They recognize Jesus for who he is. And I can't explain the mystery of this, but then Jesus is just gone. He's just gone. And then they say these powerful words. Were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? To us. They're excited. They can look back and say, you know what? Jesus was with us the entire time. He was there with us. He was there with us. He was so present. They got the check of the Spirit. They sensed the Spirit of Christ. And I want to tell you what we see, these with burning hearts, I see joyful disciples now being reconnected to Jesus. I had one of those table moments this past Tuesday. It was not actually at a meal, at a table, but it very much could have been. I was visiting in Traditions for the first time, actually in the rooms of the residents for the first time in 13 months. Now, I've gone there some back last summer in the fall. We made arrangements where I could meet one at a time in a room on the first floor to serve communion, and that was very brief encounters, and I'm thankful for those of Traditions who came out and would take that Holy Communion. But where I had this table meal was in May Knight's apartment. May, for those who don't know her, I believe, someone help me, is she 95 now? Or she's in her 90s, well in her 90s, and I think she's close to 95, just for those who don't know May. And by the way, I've talked to her about sharing this. When I knocked on her door, and I've done this often in the 3 years, and I'll hear her say, come in, I'll peep in, and May Knight is always smiling. And she greets you with that smile. And I want to tell you, there was an experience even in that moment. I couldn't help but think of when Jacob and Esau, who hadn't seen each other for a long time, and even though they had had some problems and things, but I love that scripture. When Jacob says to Esau, for to see your face is like seeing the face of God. Anybody else feel that way after all this COVID? You know, 13 months sometimes, we haven't seen somebody. And just in that first encounter, without saying the word, there was a deep kindling of the Spirit's presence. When I sat down, I sat in a recliner several feet from her, practicing the social distancing and those things. She was on her couch. We began to share about how each of our families are doing, kind of catching up as we do, and that was good. And then we talked for just a little bit how difficult it was for the folks at Traditions to go through this COVID. You see, for the most part, they had to stay in their apartments. They could no longer go for a big part of time down to what I call the wonderful community area, and that's the dinner area and the place to eat, and you would gather around tables, and that's where a lot of their relationships and communication happens. They couldn't do that. They got, you know, food served in their rooms. They couldn't have guests, even their own families, come into their rooms as well. And we just talked about that just for a few moments, and it gave me a different kind of insight. Here I am. I've been out for 13 months for the most part. But they couldn't. And she shared that. And then in the midst of that, May smiled at me. And she said, God has blessed me all of my life. And I can look back in my life, she said, and see how God had blessed me. And then she began just to share stories of that blessing. I'm going to share one of those now. And again, I asked her for permission for this. May and Louise, and I think they have a brother, maybe a few other siblings, I'm not sure. But they grew up in Casey County. That was right next to the county I served in, Russell County. So some of you have been in that area. They grew up in Casey County. They had a farm. Their dad was a farmer, and they worked hard on that farm. And May loved school, and she got to go to school through eighth grade. I think it was eighth grade, because the school back then, remember, she's in her 90s now. It's a little different than today. But the school back there, the elementary school and all, was fairly close, and they would walk to school. I was hoping if the kids were still in here, imagine this. They got to walk to school there and back, and that's one thing they would do. But after she finished eighth grade, the high school was so far away, she couldn't go to high school. And there were two reasons for that, she said. One, the buses didn't run to where they were. And being a farm family, it was really hard to be able to take the time while you're farming to get a child to drive, and however long that took to get them to school and then back from school. But this is the part that really blessed me. May said one of her main jobs when she got home, now as a teenage girl, was to get her dog, the family dog, and go out to the field and to bring the cows in with the dog. And then she said, and as I'd walk through those fields, I'd talk to God, and I'd pray. And I'd talk to God about God, could you make a way for me to go to high school? You know, I want to go to high school. Can you make a way? And she kept praying that prayer. One day, her dad had gone to Campbellsville. Anybody know where Campbellsville is? I know Tom does. Tom knows where Campbellsville is. We've been through there. And Taylor County. Her dad had gone to see a doctor. And he had kind of told her, told this doctor about May in high school. And that doctor made an arrangement. He got another family who took May in for 3 years, boarded her during the week, so she could go to Taylor County High School. And then after that family moved, that doctor took May in for her senior year to go to Taylor County. And what amazed me about May and sharing this story, she said, I want to tell you that this was all God. God did this. God did this. She got to go after high school to Lindsay Wilson. That's a story in itself. I won't go into that. One day I need to have May come and just tell us the stories for a long time. But she got to go to Lindsay just for the summer. And just after going for the summer, she got an opportunity, her first teaching opportunity, just after summer semester. And she got to teach back in Casey County. Well, if you know May's story, God would continue to provide many things I won't go into. But she ended up Western Kentucky, got her bachelor's degree, got her rank one, and she taught for years. She was an assistant principal a part of that time as well. But in all that time, she's telling this story and all these other stories, she just kept saying, this was God. And I look back, and this was God. And I want to tell you, I had that experience of the burning heart. You ever been in a place and you're talking to someone, and I call it, you get the Holy Spirit goosebumps, or your heart. And I was experienced the whole time. Now, you won't believe this or not, she was doing all the talking. And I was just listening. Anybody believe that? Say amen, right? But I was listening. And I was being blessed. And when that was happening, and I felt the Holy Spirit in that place in such a way, I thought, man, I've missed this. I've missed this. These stories. Now, we're hearing them here, but to get in the home one-on-one and to hear God at work in someone's life. And guess what? She's missed it too. She's missed being here. She's going to be here today. In fact, if I go too long, Lucy's going to have to sneak out and go get her to bring her back here for the church. And May's excited. And as I was talking to her again last night, she's excited. And in some ways, there's been folks like May who are, they're not getting reconnected to Jesus. Don't get me wrong. They know Jesus and they've been good. But the body, just being back with the body of Jesus Christ and how important that is. I went from her living room to the living room of Pat Poole. And I've only seen Pat actually when I served her communion a couple of times. And I knocked on the door again for Pat. And you get the same reaction with Pat as you do with May. She had that big smile. And come on in, and we talked some, and we talked about families and things like that. How's everybody doing? But then she talked about missing being here, really missing being here, and wanting to be here. And I said, well, hey, we're starting back, and we're practicing the distancing and all this. We've been started back, and, you know, yeah, you could come now. And then she said these words, who's that tall, slender man that picks me up? Or they used to pick me up for church. And at first I thought she was talking about Tom, because Tom and Maggie have picked her up a lot. And then she said, he's a real handsome guy. And I said, oh, that's Dale Mattingly. That's not, yeah. Actually, she did not say that part. She just said, the tall, slender man that picked me up. And then I got to Dale Mattingly. And she goes, yeah, that's him, Dale Mattingly. And so I called Dale, and I said, hey, Dale, she mentioned you, the tall, slender man, handsome, by the way, I told him. And I said, no, I was just kidding. But I said, you know, she's ready. I don't know if she'll come this week or next week, but she's been missing being here. And I'm seeing that with all kinds of people. My heart was burning. I made some other visits that day, and it's good. It was almost like being in the sweet spot and feeling the Spirit of the Lord in such a powerful way, a kindred spirit. I've heard in talking with others how good it is. Many of you have mentioned, man, it's just nice to be someplace and get to talk to someone and to be able to interact in those ways. We only have 5 or 6 in disciple the other night, but we even got off the lesson, but just began to discuss other things of life and things in the scriptures as well. It's just a great point to reconnect. You know, and I thought this is what I thought. If we're hungry for that, we need that. There's some folks just barely getting back now, have that kind of hunger. I thought, you know, there's other people that are hungry too. Maybe you haven't been connected for a long time. They're hungry. Or maybe they've never been connected as well. You know, the story does not end with the two and suddenly excited that they can look back and say, Jesus was with us this whole time. We've sensed his presence. We now understand the scriptures. He's opened our eyes to see. But it says they got up from the table. Now remember, it's evening, right? This is evening, and no telling how long Jesus had been where. They're not waiting until the next day. They got up from the table, and it says they headed back to Jerusalem. And that was so they could tell the 11 and those disciples. And they share their experience of what they experienced on the road and at the table with Jesus Christ. And folks, that's where we're at right now. I realize we're still in this time of having to be socially distant and wearing the mask, and we need to do that. We need to be as safe as we can. But I want to tell you, I think there's a time that we can share. There are a lot of people. Daryl mentioned, I appreciate the prayer that he said. You know, it's not just church folks who've been in isolation, who've been lonely, who've been afraid, as he mentioned last week, and all kinds of dynamics. There's a lot of folks who need a place at the table, a place to belong, a place of friendship, a place of love, a place of purpose, a place they can experience even one day themselves, as I've experienced. Now I see Jesus. Kind of been around his table. I just never saw him, never experienced Jesus. And as I thought about that, this old familiar friend came back to me. This was from years ago. Anybody remember a lady by the name of Fran? Raise your hand. Maybe y'all did, maybe you didn't up here. Fran was just an acronym for friends, relatives, acquaintances, and neighbors. Real simple. And I began to think about my own hunger to be in God's place in the presence of His Holy Spirit and the Spirit of Christ. And I began to think about, what about folks in these places where, by the way, I already have connections to? I've already got friends. I've already got many relatives or acquaintances. That's folks we work with, or folks we go to school with, or folks we play golf with, or do crochet with, whatever it might be. Might be folks we minister to. These might be acquaintances. They're becoming friends or neighbors. And as a church, folks, you know, we've had to kind of be inside. Now, we're doing things. I'm thankful through broadcasts and things like that's going out. Ministries to the homeless continuing, other ministries continuing. But it's time for us, and I think a very natural way of loving people, but being very intentional as well. We've got to be intentional. If we're not intentional about starting to build some bridges or relationships, I'd rather say, then there's not going to be other people to be able to be in this presence of Jesus Christ. And the first thing we've got to do, now, I know we're still in the COVID and things are opening back up, and man, I'm looking forward to summer and those types of things. But the first thing we can do for folks that you might think about, I've got folks in all of these categories, the first thing we can do even right now is to pray for them. And I mean, really pray. I'm just like May. We can walk with May, right, out in the field. Somewhere. We can walk by her side and Jesus walking with us and pray for people as we talk to him and lift them up. May said something to me the other day about her father, one thing she appreciated about her father. She said, we had devotions each evening, and my father always ended with a prayer, not only for us, his children, but for the neighbor's children as well. The prayers for others, and that's where it starts. In Disciple the other night, we got on to the Emmaus, and it wasn't from this passage, but we started talking about the Emmaus walk and how feeling that experience sometimes of, of the Holy Spirit in such a powerful way that opens people's eyes. And if you realize, there is an incredible amount of prayer that surrounds Emmaus. If we were close to that in the church, man, I tell you, we're going to start seeing some people come in. And then how do we connect to people? By the way, I want to say a thank you and a blessing. There's some folks, you've already brought some of your friends here. You've already invited some people that are now here. I've seen some other family members here as well. And you're already doing that. I was just kind of thinking, looking ahead about, you know, one thing that's we've kind of been challenged with, we've, for a large part, only had worship, right? And so sometimes it's kind of harder to invite kids. And so I'm looking forward as kids' Sunday school starting pretty soon. And we got children's church now and more avenues of opportunities for people. Bible school coming up in some form or fashion. Have to do it a little different this year, but I'm looking forward to that. And so I'm already walking and I'm already praying. Y'all know I walk with my dog Evangelist Lucky, right? And I want to tell you, I am probably better connected with the kids in my neighborhood than the adults and their parents, because these kids come out. And there's two little boys that live just a few houses across from me on the corner, and so we pass their house every time. If I'm just walking by myself or with the dog, and they always come out, and they're taught friendly boys. They're 4 and they're 6. And so I've been establishing a relationship with them and just talking to them. By the way, any leftover candy I have from the kids here in the church, they get it, by the way. And I'll take it to them, whether it's Valentine's or Easter. But the other day, one of the little boys, and we've gotten to know each other, one's Charlie, he's about 6, and he's playing baseball now, and his little brother's about 4. And Charlie was getting frustrated because he had his 4-year-old brother trying to pitch to him, you know. It was not getting to the plate, Glenn, you know, it was like this. And so Charlie said, hey, he saw me walking, hey, can you come over and pitch to me? I said, well, sure. I had some time. And so I went to start pitching to Charlie, and he started hitting the ball. And then he hit one almost to my house, and it was time for me to go at that point. But he's it's just those things. Around the corner is Colin, the skateboarder. You see him skateboarding all the time. He stops and we talk. Down from that corner is James. James and his wife, a young couple. They have a 2-year-old and they have a newborn baby. And sometimes the conversation is just over our dogs that kind of meet in the yard, or the toys the kids have. But these are just ways of making connections. Around the corner is Brad and Leah, a young couple. Again, each time we talk. For me, it's one of the most natural ways. It's just the way I get to talk and love on people. And yeah, and every once in a while I'll say, oh yeah, I go to Fern Creek, United Methodist Church, or I pastor there. The other day, one of the families was coming by with their 2 young girls, and they go, what church do you pastor again? And I told them again, and this is a very faithful Christian family. They're going to another church in the area, but we talked about things and about church. And so, guys, to be intentional to do those things again are going to be important. For us to pray about how the church can be visible again, whether it's doing some outdoor things, getting connected. I think ministries will start opening up. Some of the best ways to meet people is through ministry. You know, Jesus, the disciples knew something. He was powerful in word and deed, in both. They realized that. And then they realized his presence at the table. And it was a powerful presence. I don't know. I tell you, the other day was a wonderful time of feeling this presence right there as Jesus broke the bread and gave it to his disciples. And their eyes were open to see. And we're going to come to this table again right now. Hopefully you all picked up. Did everybody get a personal communion cup? If you didn't, raise your hand. I see Cheryl in the back. Did anybody not get one? And we just want to make sure. Most of you have been here, maybe not everyone. But if you haven't opened these before, it can be a little tricky. You'll notice there's actually 2 little tabs. One is clear, and you pull that one back to get the wafer out or the bread. And I want you just to hold on to that a moment again. And then after you get the wafer, before you partake of it, you can peel back to where you can get to the cup and the juice. And hold on to that as well. You know, when I think about that table that Jesus was at, it's pretty easy to see that he could be pointing to this communion table. But a whole lot of other things happen at the table of fellowship and forgiveness and family. And all of these things, it's literally just being in the presence of Jesus Christ at his table. And while he was with those two disciples, he took bread and he gave thanks over it. And he broke it, and you can break yours. And then he gave it. And there was something in that, that they could see Jesus. And their hearts were burning because they can sense his presence. And I pray your heart's just burning as we're in the presence of Christ again at his table. And then he would take the cup as he would on that Last Supper night. And after giving thanks over, he gave it, saying, "Take, drink the blood of the new covenant given to you this day for the forgiveness of sin." And Jesus, in extending this to us, welcomes us to his table. It's a family table, and it's his family. And let's bow for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, may you consecrate these elements, Holy Spirit, that as we partake of them, we partake of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we partake, we thank you for your death and resurrection in which you have offered us life. We thank you for a place at this table. We thank you for the forgiveness of sin. We thank you for the communion and fellowship of your Spirit who dwells in us and who is with us. Lord, thank you. We remember you in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. You may partake of the elements. And we'll have the praise team now come and share with us our closing praise song. Beautiful, beautiful song. Let's stand together. The altar is open for any need. Jesus bids to come to his table, to come to the altar. If you have any prayer concern to know Christ, I'd love to pray with you as well. But let's stand as we share.
Let us come together, walking in the Spirit. There's much to be done. We will come reaching out from our comforts, and they will know us by our love. Sisters, we were made for kindness. We can pierce the darkness as he shines through us. We will come reaching with a song of healing, and they will know us by our love. The time is now, come church arise. Firm in the truth now, set your hearts above. You will be reaching long after we're gone, and they will know you by your love. The time is now, come church arise, love with leave you, and they will.
place. May they know us by His love in us and our love for them. Go now, in Jesus' name, amen.